virtual roundtable with our friends at the AFL-CIO. Together, we established the Labor Energy Partnership last year to develop practical, achievable solutions for a 21st century clean energy transition. And we're delighted to welcome all of you to today's event, which we've entitled Accelerating the Energy Transition to Deep Decarbonization, Infrastructure, Jobs, and Inequity, a kickoff for Earth Week. Today, we will convene stakeholders from industry, unions, and government to discuss the Biden administration American Jobs Plan, the prospects for developing a bipartisan coalition for change, and the upcoming International Climate Summit at the White House later this week. A few words about our format today. First, this roundtable is open to the public and it's being live streamed on multiple platforms. The event is being recorded and will be available on YouTube. We welcome comments from public participation on Zoom, but unfortunately, given the large anticipated audience today, we won't be able to directly answer questions in real time as the conversation unfolds, but we will definitely take your questions into account as we move forward. We've attached the program for today's events on Zoom, and we will publish a summary report based on today's discussions. Finally, I want to call to your attention that we will be making a special announcement at the end of the program today about future LEP activities over the coming months. We have a very packed agenda, and so we will be keeping all of our introductory comments at a minimum. And so with that, it's my pleasure to turn the program over and introduce you to Cecil Roberts, President of the United Mine Workers of America. Cecil?
Well, thank you very much. It's wonderful to be here today with everybody. My job here is to speak about 2 minutes, if I can hold it to that, about how we formed the Labor Energy Partnership. I would start out with my good friend Lonnie Stevenson and I are co-chairs of the Energy Committee at the AFL-CIO. And one of the things that we have been very much interested in is carbon capture and sequestration. And of course, Energy Future Initiative has always been ahead of the game with respect to that. All of us at the AFL-CIO had the opportunity to work with former Secretary of Energy Moniz. And so Lonnie and I set up a meeting, excuse me, through Dave to Foster to have a meeting with Ernie and his key staff. We took our key staff with us, that's Lonnie and I, from each union, IBEW and UMWA. And I believe this was just before Christmas of 2019, pre-pandemic. Had a wonderful meeting and decided that we should discuss and possibly form a partnership with the former secretary's organization. But me knowing my place in life, I said, we need to take this to Rich before we get too much further down the road. So Lonnie and I visited with Rich and his staff. And from there, Rich and his staff, along with Ernie's staff, had a conversation. And we decided through the Energy Committee at the AFL-CIO and through the appropriate representatives of Ernie's organization that this would be a partnership that we should form. That was finalized. And I believe Rich and Ernie, forgive me for not using your proper titles, but this is the way we talk up Cabin Creek. This partnership has wonderful possibilities. We're moving along. And with that, it brings us today. So, Secretary Moniz, the floor is yours.
Well, thank you, Cecil. And I can assure you that we are all equally pleased with this partnership and especially gaining traction as we will be increasingly doing on the road to Glasgow. But today, as part of the LEP, it's my pleasure to, first of all, welcome our partner, Rich Trumka, President of AFL-CIO, and a very special welcome to Jennifer Granholm, the Secretary of Energy. And these are two champions and authorities on quality job creation during the energy transition, and that's what we'll probe today in this discussion. So I'll start with Secretary Granholm. The President Biden, as you know very well, recently announced the American Jobs Plan with ambition, with a multi-year, multi-pronged effort to transform our infrastructure systems. And I'd love to hear your take on how it's going to accelerate the clean energy transition and create a good paying union jobs.
Well, thank you, Secretary Moniz, and thank you, President Trumka, for this, for your marriage here, as well as for this ability to be able to come and talk to you about the American Jobs Plan and what certainly our role at DOE. Obviously, I'm building on a heck of a lot of the foundation that you laid, Secretary Moniz, in focusing on the technologies that are going to get us to a carbon-free future by 2050, and all the steps along the way. So it's an honor to be able to follow in your footsteps and to talk a little bit about the American Jobs Plan in particular. The name is not a misnomer. The plan is about jobs in all sorts of areas, whether it's construction or advanced manufacturing or caregiving. But as you can guess, obviously, we at the Department of Energy are most thrilled about the investments that it makes in our clean energy industries. So the American Jobs Plan is going to allow us to deploy the technology we have right now to reach these clean energy goals, which means adding hundreds of gigawatts of zero carbon energy at the same time as expanding our transmission system so we can move this clean energy from production centers from where it's generated to high demand areas. So this stuff doesn't just appear out of thin air. It's going to take millions of people getting to work, which is what this is all about. And this partnership that you have with labor, because we need to put millions of people to work pouring concrete and putting steel in the ground. And this audience knows that it means so many American workers in roles like engineering and construction and project management, operations. And, you know, we know that too often today, some of those clean energy construction jobs aren't going to union labor. If we're going to be honest about it, we are committed to doing something about that. It's why the American Jobs Plan proposes for the first time ever to connect clean energy tax credits to good labor standards. And of course, that's not enough either. We all want good union jobs building and installing clean energy technology, but we want to be installing American-made clean energy technology. We want good union jobs in manufacturing too. And that's why the American Jobs Plan proposes an absolutely historic investment in American manufacturing, $300 billion. And a good portion of that is going to be to win the future in clean energy manufacturing, from offshore wind to transmission components to the full supply chain from on the vehicle, from critical minerals to batteries to the electric vehicles themselves. It's really critical to recognize that what we're talking about here is a $23 trillion global market for clean energy products, for products that will reduce greenhouse gas emissions. That's what experts are saying is out there. That's what the world is going to be investing in, the globe and all the countries that have signed on to the Paris Accord. So the question for us is, where are those products going to be made? It means that for us, we cannot just sit idly by and allow our economic competitors to get those products. We need to make things here and to sell them to, you know, use them here and to sell them to other countries. And if we don't get moving, other countries like China are going to eat our lunch. So the American Jobs Project or plan knows and acknowledges this urgency of the moment. It is our bid to win these markets. It's our bid to launch world leading industries right here. It's our bid to employ millions of Americans building those technologies, stamping them made in America, selling them here and selling them abroad. But we're going to put people to work here. So that's what it's all about.
Great. That's Very enthusiastic. And I have to say that your and the president's commitment to the union jobs, I think, is borne out by studies that we have done in terms of the pay, the benefits, the quality, the training that comes with those union jobs, which in fact, Rich, our report on the energy and employment situation both found a huge premium. Oh, and by the way, I want to also thank Secretary Granholm for reestablishing the Energy and Employment Report at the Department of Energy. We have found things like a 34% premium in energy jobs over the national median wage. We found that that pre-COVID energy jobs were expanding at twice that of the economy as a whole. But we also know, when you've talked about a disparity within the energy sector in terms of pay, let's say energy efficiency versus utility jobs. And perhaps you could talk about that. How do you see that issue of the jobs quality piece?
Well, thanks, Ernie. And good afternoon and happy Earth Week to everybody. I want to first thank Brother Cecil Roberts and Ernie. I want to thank you. You know how much I appreciate working together through the energy partnership, labor energy partnership. And Secretary Granholm, keep up that energy and passion. And on behalf of the 12.5 million working people in the 56 unions of the AFL-CIO, I want to thank you. Thank you for not only being here, but thank you for what you do every day. And to both of you, I want to say how much it helps working families when the Secretary of Energy is pro-worker. Look, we're facing the threat of climate change, the challenge of keeping and creating good union jobs, the urgent need to secure workers' rights and dignity, and rights and dignity for every worker, all colors, creeds, faith, genders, orientations, abilities, and experiences. And that's the full scope of diversity that makes us America. Because we address the climate crisis, we will confront deep-rooted inequality, systems built on stolen land and labor, structures from the Jim Crow South, 40 years of trickle-down economics, neglected infrastructure, and offshoring. The inequality of income, the inequality of opportunity, and the inequality of power that have left communities all across the U.S. behind. But with President Biden, I'm confident those days are over, because that's what he promised. And I've known him for 40 years. He's a man of his word. His climate goals are ambitious, but this is America, and we do big things. And the best, we would argue, the only path forward runs through the labor movement. And that's why the president's executive order on climate calls for well-paying union jobs. Secretary Granholm, we appreciate your leadership. We hear you calling for millions of good-paying union jobs to build the equitable, clean energy future that we need and deserve. We appreciate that you want to invest in us. I happen to be a third-generation Pennsylvania coal miner. Those jobs built this country. And my union, the United Mine Workers of America, made coal mining a middle-class job. They didn't start out that way. Across our economy, industry by industry, that's how unions built the American dream. And as we transition to clean energy, we're not going to give up an inch or sacrifice a dollar for false promises of just retraining. See, we're not going to walk away from places like Greene County, Pennsylvania, where I grew up. We'll fight climate change with everything we have, but we simply won't allow the transition to be done on our backs. Working families will tune you out if it's going to cost us the ability to feed a family or a toehold in the middle class. We need job creation up front, not to be determined. See, there should be an investment in jobs plan in every community that lost or will lose coal jobs. Every community where plants will no longer make transmissions or steel. Every community that suffers from environmental damage. each person and every one of those places matters. And we know the Biden administration gets it. And that's the hope and the promise of building back better for racial justice, gender equality, with union labor unions. If our rights, dignity, and power are at the center of the clean energy transition, then we will create widespread opportunities. We'll lift each other up out of poverty and away from the margins into a new era of possibilities. And the single greatest key is passing the PRO Act, which guarantees a free and a fair path to a union. See, coal companies didn't gift us living wages and safety protections. They literally nickeled and dimed us to death. They told us that breathing coal dust was good for our lungs. My union won job security and quality through collective bargaining, not through corporate benevolence. And we had to fight for every single inch in right, for every protection, for every raise. And workers paid in blood, spilled by coal and iron police. See, we can't answer the climate crisis if we have to fight those battles all over again. We must learn from the past. Calling it a green or a clean job doesn't make it a good job. Doesn't equal family supporting wages and doesn't mean retirement security. Workers in renewable energy sectors need a free and a fair path to organize, to make those jobs good jobs. Now, equitable clean energy means universal labor rights and local opportunities for every person and every place in America. And that's why this discussion today is so important. We're grateful to have you, Secretary Granholm. Thank you. Thank you very much. Ernie, I'll give it back
to you. Thank you. Thank you, Rich. Secretary Granholm, you mentioned EVs briefly, and of course, the president has an executive order on looking at the supply chain security. You're looking at the battery supply chains. Can you talk a little bit more about how we diversify and secure the EV supply chain from, as you say, from minerals to batteries?
Yeah. I mean, thank you for that. And hopefully we can chat a little bit about some of the equity issues that President Trumka raised maybe after this as well, because I think he's so right on. But I am completely passionate about the supply chain issue as well. You know, as anybody, in fact, y'all know as anybody else does, that we import most of our supplies for the critical materials that are essential to battery storage, that are essential to clean energy technologies, and you know, most modern consumer technologies as well. So the Department of Interior has this list of 35 critical mineral commodities that power technologies, essential, you know, all essential to modern society. And of those 35, we import 100% of our supply of 14 of them, and over 50% of our supply from 17 others. It's insane. And yet we've got a lot of those minerals beneath our feet. They're, in many cases, what we import is coming from economic rivals and countries that are committing human rights violations. So not only are we effectively propping up these other countries, we're leaving our own production capacity at a heightened risk of disruption over trade disputes or natural disasters on the other side of the world, armed conflicts, and not to mention that we are leaving our own people behind in terms of their ability to take these jobs. So it is unacceptable, and it's not sustainable either. If we want the economic security we need in the 21st century, we have to build the batteries and those other technologies in America with American materials using American labor. And that means that our goal is to both produce and process critical minerals here in the United States. We don't process anything here. We've got all these strategies to pursue, all of which would create jobs, but we can't forget processing. We actually produce a decent amount of raw critical materials in the US. We do a lot of that. But then we ship it overseas for processing, and then we re-import it. It's nuts. We should build processing plants responsibly here. And the next part is, how do we produce more of the materials that we are processing? That's just doing more to mine responsibly for material here with the best environmental and health protection, in addition to labor protections. But there are also other opportunities. So for example, companies are producing commercial grade lithium out of the left behind tailings from old mine sites in the process of cleaning up those sites. That's also, those are industrial jobs and environmental restoration at the same time. And we should do more of that as well. In fact, DOE is investing in research and development around extracting critical minerals from the waste left at coal mines and from the coal ash that has been left at power plants. So those could unlock industrial jobs in the specific communities that have already been hard hit by the market shift away from coal. And then of course, there's also recycling. We throw away products with critical minerals every single day when we could be creating jobs to extract those minerals and processes into new materials. And the other thing is, we wanna make sure that we not only have the supplies needed for those products, but we have the ability to put them together and build those products here. And it's why the American Jobs Project plan makes hundreds of billions in investments to revitalize the manufacturing base. And I can just say too, I mean, I feel this so deeply because I was the former governor of a manufacturing state at a time when, as a nation, we just sort of stood idly by as we watched our economic competitors take all of these good manufacturing jobs. This president is saying no more. We are not going to stand by and let our economic competitors corner the market, which they have been doing. We're going to say, yes, it's time for responsible government help, support, intervention to make sure that we can achieve our own economic security, our own energy security, and certainly our own national security. We have got to do this. That's what the American Jobs Plan is all about.
That's great. And I love to hear your point about on the critical minerals, not only producing, but also recycling and looking for substitutes for, right, for those materials. What do you think about striving for net zero mining?
Awesome. You can leave this project. Let's do it.
Okay. We'll talk in the morning about that. Right? Rich, did you want to shoot something at the secretary?
I do. Secretary Granholm, as it is, many solar panels are manufactured with parts built in China using forced labor. Well, it's not clean energy if any component is powered by forced labor. How will investing in America's supply chains set global labor standards for clean energy production? And how fast can we establish a domestic solar manufacturing sector?
Yeah, this is a great point. And I would also say, like, for example, the Democratic Republic of the Congo is mining cobalt, and they have human rights violations too, using child labor. And we have a whole bunch of economic partners on the other side of the pond who want responsibly produced materials for their own goals of using clean energy. So the simple fact is, when we manufacture products in America, we know that those products are made with a certain guarantee of worker safety, worker classification, certainly making sure that we're not violating any human rights. And those workers are provided protective equipment, and their workplaces have to meet quality, you know, health and safety standards. And especially when it comes to union manufacturing, the workers behind those products are supported with good pay and good health care and strong job security. So I think it's fair to say that when we as a nation bow to the altar of low cost, this race to the bottom that we have been engaged in for the first two decades of this century, and just import goods from anyone offering the cheapest deal, those guarantees go out the window, and certainly our economic security goes out the window. So it's hard to argue to the rest of the world that they should treat workers well and keep them safe and pay them fairly when we're buying products from companies and countries that don't do that. But if we make the investments in the American Jobs Plan that they call for to revitalize this manufacturing sector, the $300 billion worth in total, $46 billion specifically for clean energy manufacturing, we can create a global gold standard for worker treatment. We can create a standard where prevailing wages are the baseline, where project labor agreements are commonplace, where we're making sure that employers valuing workers are given a leg up over the unscrupulous ones. So all of that is a way for us to help our brothers and sisters in other countries, but it's also a way for us to help our own workers. And with respect to the timeframe, I am so impatient. My hair is on fire to be able to get this done. We have, 948 days left that we are guaranteed in this first term. That's all we know we have. And so I know that to take mining done, or to get solar panels, a solar panel fabrication facility set up, it takes some time. We want to make sure that they are located, especially in places that might disproportionately benefit from having those job opportunities. So it does take a little bit of time. But please know that not only is my hair on fire, everybody's hair is on fire. The president is demanding that we get some action, that we see some results. To your point about putting jobs in places, that the jobs go first, and then you can train people for the jobs that are there. So we are all in on this strategy of accelerating the siting, the permitting, the placement of jobs in these in this clean energy space, so that we can be a model for the rest of the world.
Thank you. Let me ask the question about the American communities that have been seen or unseen or abandoned or left behind. I'm thinking specifically of the folks in my hometown, Nemacolin, Pennsylvania, or Cecil's hometown, Cabin Creek, West Virginia. My little town was a coal company town. And that means the mining companies owned everything. Even the houses, they printed and paid in money that could only be used at coal-owned businesses. It was called scrip. And the entire local economy depended on coal. And when the company shuttered, it hurt everyone, from the elderly to our school children. We lost a real part of our identity. And I know that the Department of Energy has been leading President Biden's interagency working group on coal communities. What are the plans for those communities in the clean energy transition?
Yeah, thank you for asking that. I feel this so deeply, as somebody who was the governor of a state that was sort of a one industry state, right? We were manufacturing, and auto manufacturing was our identity. And when that was threatened, when they went into bankruptcy, you know, you cannot stand by and just say that's fine. People should just move. We've got, as a nation, to wrap our arms around communities that have been told their entire life that they're helping to power America, and all of a sudden the market has moved in a different direction and they have the rug pulled out from under them. So when you read the details of the American Jobs Plan, I hope one thing that stands out is our commitment to the coal communities, other energy communities, rural communities, declining industrial communities that have been left behind. We are dead serious about doing everything possible to make sure this energy transition is this new, more equitable economy really does create opportunity. And so the first week in office, President Biden signed this executive order that you mentioned on coal and power plant communities, and tasked the Department of Energy with staffing a whole of government process to figure out how to do right by them. You are going to hear more about that soon. Because this week is the focus has been on this energy, Earth Week, et cetera. I'm hoping that we'll be able to release the report this week, but we may not be able to. Depends on what the timing is. But the bottom line is, know that they have done a screen to identify the communities that have been hardest hit by the market movement, by, you know, the fossil communities that are seeing their opportunities shrink. And we are focused on identifying the resources of the federal government and partnering to be able to direct benefits to those communities. And not just training benefits, as you mentioned. We really want to get job providers to locate in these communities. And you're going to, as I say, you're going to hear more about that. But after, you know, this inclusive strategy, we want to give members of these communities a seat at the table and ask for their input. We're going to be using that input to guide decisions around these place-based strategies. We're building this approach into the American Jobs Plan, which is going to propose billions of dollars for place-based strategies to bring every American community along, but especially those who have been left behind. For example, the American Jobs Plan is going to launch 15 decarbonized hydrogen demonstrations. So, you know, blue or green hydrogen demonstration projects in these communities, we hope. 10 pioneer carbon capture retrofits in steel, cement, chemical plants, power plants, all distressed communities, and leading the way for industrial facilities to operate with lower or no carbon emissions. We consider, and I know Secretary Moniz knows this, we consider DOE to be the solutions department. We've got solutions to CO2 emissions. We just need to make sure we've got the places and the partnerships to make sure that technology is installed and that people are trained to be able to work on those technologies. When we build the industries of the future in these communities, we're committed to creating and maintaining jobs in the short term, the medium term, with skills matched work. And you know, on that, the American Jobs Plan also calls for an immediate $16 billion in capping oil and gas wells and in reclaiming coal and hard rock mines and reducing methane leaks. All kinds of jobs for all kinds of people. Energy workers should be able to jump right into those. And the final thing I would want to say about this, President Trumka, is that it is worth noting that an estimated 90% of the jobs that are created by the American Jobs Plan will take a little more than high school diploma, you know, high school diploma, maybe some short-term training. So it opens the aperture for who can get a good paying job. And we're going to invest $100 billion in workforce development to ensure that anybody who wants those jobs are going to be able to get them.
Secretary Granholm, I have a feeling we could go on with this discussion for a long time, but time is running out. So let me just skip to one last question. And you pushed the magic button in saying DOE as the solutions department. So you're still relatively new there. What excites you about the technology innovation agenda? I mean, besides everything, you know, a few priorities.
All right. So one, I love the, I love hydrogen. The hydrogen economy is super exciting. Number one, I love new ways to create hydrogen, through water, maybe even through seawater. I love the fact that ARPA-E is figuring out how to build new batteries, even from like iron from dirt. So amazing. I love the fact that we're supporting all these projects in next generation solar technology, like perovskite cells. In the early phases, but you know, that's exciting. I love the fact that we're investing in tried and true technology, but that we haven't deployed yet, like geothermal, which can provide, you know, great jobs in many communities. So there's so much going on. Tidal wave power, the building of the offshore wind, the 30 gigawatts of offshore wind that was just committed to by the Biden administration off the Atlantic coast, the building the next generation transmission grid. I'm telling you, there's all kinds of jobs, all kinds of people, all kinds of technology, very future looking, and I'm very excited about it all.
And I'm going to take the liberty of adding to your list,
yes,
carbon dioxide removal.
Yes,
let's remove the legacy CO2 also.
Direct air capture, CCUS, you name it.
Yeah. Well, terrestrial, mineralization.
Yes, that too.
Right. So, okay. All right. We're all excited. And this has been great. It's a shame we have to end our time together here today, but we look forward to resuming this discussion. Rich, you have a last benediction?
All I want to say is, look, now I know why they call it the energy department. Right. It has energized the secretary, I can tell you that. And that energizes all of us. I want to thank you for thinking about all those communities that have been unseen and forgotten in the process of planning everything. And we look forward to working with you to make a much better place in America where everybody gets a chance to get ahead. So thanks for all your work. Stay safe.
Well, right, thanks, Rich. And again, thanks, Secretary Granholm. Thank you very much. And let me now introduce another great friend from the AFL-CIO, Secretary Treasurer Liz Schuler.
Great. Thank you so much. And hello, Secretary Moniz. I want to thank you for your partnership and your vision. It's great to be here with this all-star lineup. I wanted to thank everyone in the Labor Energy Partnership as well. And I would say, like Secretary Granholm, I'm passionate about these issues and thrilled to just have a couple of minutes here. Many of you know the AFL-CIO is made up of 56 unions, 12 and a half million working people from all across the country in every sector of the economy. What a lot of people don't know is that the labor movement is the largest organization of working women in the country. Yes, working women, 6.5 million union women and growing. And I like to point out, of course, as a woman leader who came up through my union, the IBEW, and as we talk about how we're going to build an equitable clean energy future, those jobs are absolutely jobs for women. And I think Vice President Harris recently said, hard hats are unisex. And I love that line because I think it's so important for President Biden's climate goals to be thinking about how we connect the clean energy infrastructure investments from the American Jobs Plan to the goal of an equitable recovery and energy future. Because we know COVID-19 has touched every community, but women are shouldering the greatest burdens. Black and Latina women are suffering the greatest job losses. And for those who are sidelined or those who want to leave a low-wage job or gig employment, the labor movement is the bridge. And our apprenticeship readiness and apprenticeship programs are the bridge that gets workers into those clean energy infrastructure jobs and onto a pathway into the middle class with a family supporting career. And we in the labor movement are laser focused on recruiting women and people of color and veterans and the formerly incarcerated. And as I said, I came up through the IBEW. I have seen how a union apprenticeship and a career in the building trades can change someone's life. Like the single mom living on the Standing Rock Reservation who got herself and her children out of homelessness by becoming an apprentice with the Boilermakers Union. And she is now supporting her family with so much pride and so much dignity, right? Because a union job is more than a job, it is a career. It's a sense of empowerment and it's a high quality of life and it gives you good health care and the ability to retire with dignity with a union pension. And not to mention the sense of belonging when you have the support of a broader movement of working people who are all pulling in the same direction. So as we transition to clean energy, we need to think about workers as a vital part of the innovation process. And I was thinking back as folks were talking about how green building standards evolved, right? We now have LEED certified buildings that are the highest level of commitment. How do you get there without the highest level of skilled qualified workers? It's like we need a LEED platinum workforce, right? To make it happen. And that goes for the entire clean energy economy. And that's where the labor movement comes in. We're not just a point of entry, we're the platform for constant upskilling and the stacked credentials that everyone's talking about. And we wanna be the place where workers from one sector can actually shift into another sector without leaving their community. There was a lot of discussion about that already. And as Rich said, we need to pass the PRO Act so we can organize and bring new clean energy industries up to that highest workforce standard. A voice on the job, fairness, family supporting pay and benefits, and the American dream, right? That we all aspire to. We can do this. We have the ability to make these choices now. And we need the support of our elected officials at every level, especially in Congress. And that's why I'm thrilled to introduce, I think by video, US Senator Cory Booker. Senator Booker has served as the junior US Senator from New Jersey since 2013. Formerly the mayor of Newark since 2006, he created the city's first ever Office of Sustainability. And during his time in the Senate, he has cemented his reputation as an environmental leader. He's a member of the Senate Climate Action Task Force and has worked to elevate the response to the climate crisis, including joining 30 of his Senate colleagues in an overnight session where they had floor speech after floor speech pushing for action on climate change. And we are thrilled to bring some remarks from him now. I'll say thank you and take it away, Senator Booker.
We seem to have a problem here with audio.
On the assembly lines during World War II. Growing up, I would hear from my granddad what a union meant to him and my family, how that union fought for him, organized for him, and advocated for him so that he could support his family, could raise my mom, send her to college. And that's why he became a union organizer. So many of us grew up with this understanding. And listen, we know that the unions have made a pathway to the middle class, to a job with dignity. And it is that tradition, your tradition, our American tradition of solidarity and coalition building in the face of the biggest challenges that is more important now than ever. Because we do not have time to wait for climate action. You don't need me to tell you that we know what the climate impacts are going to be, such as heat waves, extreme storms, droughts, and megafires. They're all worsening, threatening the health of our communities and ecosystems. You all know this. You know that as temperatures rise every year, we face long-term and irreversible ecological consequences alongside rising threats to the most vulnerable low-income communities, communities of color, indigenous communities. These are the folks who are on the front lines of these challenges, the front lines and are most at risk. You know that urgent action is critical if we are going to avoid the most catastrophic consequences of climate change. That's why we're here, because rising to the challenges of climate change and deep decarbonization present us with a unique opportunity to build an economy that is centered around equity and fairness for communities and working people. There's a win-win opportunity here. We don't have to choose between creating good jobs and protecting the environment. We can and we must do both. By transitioning to a clean, resilient economy, we can lift communities up by correcting from past policy failures that have contributed to the climate crisis, while also creating millions of good-paying, high-quality jobs that can fortify and expand America's middle class, helping families like mine go from challenge and even poverty to success. Meeting the rising global demand for energy while simultaneously slashing carbon emissions presents a critical challenge for our generation. Look, the Paris Climate Change Agreement sets an ambitious target to limit global warming to 1.5 degrees Celsius above pre-industrial levels. By 2050, meeting the Paris targets would require the world to cut carbon emissions by up to 70% while producing 70% more electricity. we are in a race against climate change. And in order to avert the worst consequences, I believe nuclear energy needs to be part of the solution. Nuclear energy, which provides critical baseload power, currently comprises 20% of total US electricity generation and more than 60% of our nation's carbon-free electrical generation. The nuclear energy industry provides long-term, high-paying jobs in fields ranging from electricians to machinists to electrical and nuclear energy engineers, reactor operators, and so many more. And because of pending retirements, the industry expects to hire 25,000 new workers over the next several years. And the existing fleet of nuclear reactors is staying online. But several existing reactors have recently been shut down prematurely, and many more stand at risk. We need sound, long-term federal policies that will support our existing fleet, help to make it safer and stronger, and also support the dozens of private sector companies that are investing billions of dollars to develop advanced nuclear reactors that can be commercialized in the near future, creating more and more jobs. These advanced reactors have the potential to be more economical, safer, and generate less wastes. I am proud to have co-authored three bipartisan bills in recent years that were signed into law that will help facilitate development of the next generation of nuclear reactors. What Congress needs to do next is provide the Department of Energy and our national labs with sufficient funding to help facilitate the development of demonstration reactor projects that can accelerate the commercialization of next generation advanced reactors. Nuclear energy can be part of a solution to climate change that is built around our workers and our unions, and that helps us to transition to the brighter future that all of us are striving for. Advancing American leadership in clean technology innovation and deployment, building and modernizing resilient infrastructure projects, and investing in natural climate solutions will allow us to create a new generation of high quality, good paying union jobs across the country and meet the urgency of the crisis of climate change. Together, we can invest in American communities. Together, we can protect and empower American workers. Together, we can take on climate change. And together, we will build a stronger, cleaner, and more equitable America. Thank you again for inviting me to join you. Thank you for all that you all are doing. May God bless our efforts, and may God bless America. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Liz Schuller, for your remarks about women and unions, and also thanks to Senator Booker for his tape comments, particularly focusing on nuclear energy. We will now turn to the first of two panels that we have today. My colleague, Melanie Kinderdine, will moderate the first discussion, which we've entitled Decarbonization and Increased Electrification, Generation, Transmission, and Job Needs. And I will now turn it over to her to introduce each of our distinguished participants.
Great, thank you so much. And as Joe said, I'm Melanie Kinderdine. I'm moderating today's first panel, and the title of the panel is Decarbonization and Increased Electrification, Generation, Transmission, and Job Needs. I'm a principal at the Energy Futures Initiative. I'm on the steering committee of the LEP. Before we get started with the panel, let me say Happy Earth Week. It's a great week to celebrate the renewed focus on climate change mitigation by the Biden administration and the Congress. And I'm going to deviate from what I just wrote and say I was very inspired by Liz Schuller's remarks about women And I've worked for 4 out of 16 secretaries of energy. Only one of them was a woman. Looks like to me now 2 of 16 secretaries of energy are women. I think that's great, but it's still only 12.5% if my calculation is correct. So love to see more women in running the Department of Energy. And I'm going to introduce our distinguished panelists in the interest of time. I'll just give you their names, organizations, titles. Their detailed bios are in the program you should have received. First, I'm going to start with Lonnie Stevenson. Lonnie is the international president of the IBEW. Lonnie is also on the LEP steering committee with us. Maria Korsnick, excuse me, is the president and CEO of the Nuclear Energy Institute. Tom Kuhn is president of the Edison Electric Institute. Karen Harbert, president and CEO of the American Gas Association, and Mark McManus, president of the United Association of Plumbers and Pipe Fitters. We're gonna start with a couple of minutes from each of the panelists focused on an opening question. So it's an opening statement and a broad focus. And the question is, in the context of your organization's agenda, what are your key priorities this year for the Congress and the Biden administration? And I'm gonna start off with Lonnie. Lonnie? Thank you.
Good afternoon, Melanie, and thank you. Let me say what an honor it is to work with you, Secretary Moniz, Rich Strumka, and Cecil Roberts, and founding the Labor Energy Partnership. I can't tell you how proud I am to be part of that organization. As president of the largest union of energy workers in North America, this discussion on how we can transition to a clean energy future while investing in good union jobs is more important than ever. You can find our members work in every sector of the energy industry, so fighting not to only protect the existing jobs, but to expand opportunities to create millions more energy jobs as well is my priority. For the IBEW, the top issue for Congress and the Biden administration is the American Jobs Plan. This isn't just a long overdue modernization of roads, bridges, and transportation infrastructure. It's a vital investment in modernizing our energy grid and a big boost to clean energy technologies. As the legislation's name says, this isn't just an infrastructure or a climate bill, it's a jobs bill. And that must be for everyone's priority. That's why we support strong labor protections like prevailing wage laws, expanded collective bargaining rights to make sure that green jobs are good union jobs. That's our agenda as a union. And I'm glad to hear and be here with our labor industry and policy leaders as we work to build our nation back better. Thank you.
Great, thank you so much, Lonnie. And next we're gonna turn to Maria Korsnick with NEI. Hi, Maria.
Thank you, Melanie. It's an honor to be here. And I thank Secretary Granholm for the work that she's doing. We really appreciate the focus that the Biden administration has on reducing emissions, and we're happy to be a part of the solution. And of course, thank you to Secretary Moniz for his role in sparking our transition to a carbon-free energy system. My message today really is simple. Over the last year, the conversation around the climate crisis has changed dramatically. We're making ambitious and necessary commitments, and we're not going to meet them without nuclear energy. So our priorities are both to sustain the current fleet and to build that next generation of advanced technologies. I couldn't have said it better than Senator Booker, and he noted in his remarks, nuclear energy gives us the ability to make meaningful progress right now. The US nuclear fleet is the largest source of carbon-free energy anywhere on Earth. It provides 20% of the US total electricity and over half of our carbon-free electricity. And in 2020, for the first time, nuclear became the second largest source of electricity in the United States. But right now, there's almost a carbon bomb that's gonna get ready to go off in Illinois. 4 nuclear plants are at risk of closure this year. And if we let these plants close, the lost carbon-free generation would be equivalent to all the renewables that we deployed in 2019 across the entire country. It's so important that we take action to preserve these at-risk plants. I understand the pain that plant closures cause, whether they're nuclear or any other source. And that's why investment in nuclear energy should be targeted to communities that have long relied on fossil fuels. Despite the challenges, I do think our future is bright, spurred by commitments from utilities, private investment, and government support. That next generation of nuclear is poised to come online. Technologies like small modular reactors, microreactors, and other advanced designs will make nuclear even more affordable and even more versatile. And we're building an unparalleled coalition for developing this next generation of nuclear and making it the core of our clean energy system. The Biden administration, labor organizations, NGOs, utilities, and lawmakers on both sides of the aisle value the jobs, carbon-free electricity, and partnerships that nuclear produces. Nuclear is the energy source that can make it all work. Either we're serious about building a better energy future, or we aren't. So let's protect carbon-free generation and good-paying quality jobs that will help all of us build back better.
Great. Thank you so much, Maria. That was wonderful. Tom Kuhn, an old friend and colleague.
Melanie, thank you, and thank you for the leadership of you and Ernie. And, you know, I should just start out by just saying I agree with everything that Melanie and Maria said. Basically, we are on a mission to have our energy and get as clean as we can, as fast as we can. And I think we're making remarkable progress. We reduce our carbon emissions by 40% of 2005 levels.
We seem to be having
Tom, can you turn up your volume? We're having a tough time hearing you.
Okay, can you hear me now?
Yeah, but there's a lot of feedback.
Okay.
There's one in every panel, Tom. Okay. So why don't I go to Karen while you work on your problems, Tom, and I would like to go to Karen, and as I said, she's head of AGA. I would make one comment too. If you count the moderator, this panel's 50-50 women and men, but the moderator is a woman. Okay, so anyway, Karen, love to hear from you. Thanks.
Melody, thanks. And I think this is the first time I've ever had the opportunity to pinch hit for Tom Kuhn. So I'm going to love every second of this. You know, if you look at this panel, Melanie, every one of us has made a significant contribution to keeping this country running during this pandemic. And I know all of us are committed to getting this economy back on track while still meeting our environmental goals. And our member companies are all in. We see ourselves as a big part of the solution. And right now I'm sitting here in my dining room. 180 million Americans are using natural gas right now, which of course are not just their homes, their offices, schools, gymnasiums, and 5.5 million businesses are using natural gas. And our members are committed to continue to invest in improving the system. They invest over $90 million every day to reduce emissions and make the system safer. We invest $4 million every day on energy efficiency to help our customers, those homes, those residences, to become more energy efficient and lower their carbon footprint. So far, our investments have allowed us to reduce our methane emissions by 73%, but we're not done. And we're all in on continuing to advance our environmental goals, which are everyone's environmental goals. And a note on our workforce, we employ over 4 million Americans, good paying jobs, and 83% of those jobs are in the communities in which they serve. So these are local jobs. These are in communities that are underserved, but we can do more. We are adding a customer every minute of every day. We're investing in more infrastructure. We're investing in more technology. And the secretary got passionate about hydrogen. We share her passion. We've got 7 projects up and running and are investing $100 million in hydrogen research and in research and deployment of renewable natural gas. So I like to say we've got an innovation agenda that is unbelievably, her hair's on fire, our hair's on fire, and we're all in. So maybe, great. Tom, did I filibuster enough to get you back
online?
Thank you.
Let's thank you, Karen. Let's see if Tom is back up and running.
I don't know. Can you hear me now?
Yeah, yay.
All right, terrific. We just, sometimes you got to log in and log out. But I tell you what, I just wanted to say that, you know, we are very, very much on a mission to get our energy as clean as we can, as fast as we can. And we've made remarkable progress that nobody would have thought we would have made working with the unions. We have essentially reduced our carbon emissions by more than 40% from 2005 levels already. Half of our generation is carbon free. It's been said that you know, our main priority is the American Jobs Plan, the Clean Energy Standard. The timelines are very, very challenging. I think we've got to work on them. We've got to make sure, as Senator Booker said and Maria said, that nuclear is, as existing nuclear is included. We can't backtrack if we want to make those goals from the, because nuclear is now providing 50% of our carbon-free electricity. We've got to make sure natural gas is there for us, because we've used natural gas essentially to reduce our carbon emissions, and our international members were very much needed as well. We have to work on the carbon-free technologies that are going to help us get to that last 20%, including advanced storage, long-term storage, hydrogen, carbon capture and storage, advanced nuclear. We're going to have to build out the transmission system, and we appreciate the provisions in the plan that are going to help us build additional transmission. And again, the important thing here is jobs in the communities we serve. We not only have to get the energy clean, we've got to keep it reliable and affordable, but we've also, as we transition to this cleaner economy, make sure we take care of our workers who have gotten us there at this point in time, and to make sure that they have good paying jobs in this cleaner economy. So again, a lot of work to do, but I think we're on a path to success.
Great, thank you. Thank you so much, Tom. And then finally, Mark, a few comments from you.
Sure, thank you very much. I feel like I'm batting cleanup on the 27 Yankees. Not that I'm declaring myself as Babe Ruth, but it's a wonderful panel and good friends on the panel. And hearing from, first of all, Secretary Granholm, just the energy that's coming out of her and coming out of that department in the energy sector. It's unique that way. Then Liz following her, just, you know, lights us up, I think, lights Lonnie and myself up as labor leaders here on the call. Cory Booker from my home state, speaking the right language and believing where we need to be, along with Maria on nuclear power, is just fantastic for the IBEW, the UA, and fantastic for America as well. The UA represents about 360,000 men and women across the nation, and we are all the above. I think that's what this is about, from hydrogen to carbon capture, small modular nukes to the future nuclear fleet, but certainly the current nuclear fleet that Maria spoke so eloquently about. Water and natural gas. Natural gas is in the Democratic platform. It's been in the Democratic platform. It's more than a bridge. We can argue about how long that bridge is, but that is where we need to be realistically, if we want to be realistic about this. Our priorities, the question was, is Lonnie's priorities as well, the American Jobs Plan and the labor protections in that plan. We need good labor protections. We've fought for years and years and years on good Davis-Bacon, on roads and highways and bridges, which it should be there. It should be in the futures where we go forward as well. You know, the president's leadership is outstanding on the COVID relief packages to get the most needy folks just the basic goods to get them out of this economy. But our folks, you know, we're not looking to hold the line. We're looking to move forward with the American Jobs Plan. And that's what we're most excited about with the administration, putting in the good labor protections. And we have the biggest skilled workforce, the national building trades, all the different building trades. We're going to take care of the education part of this, the highest standard that Liz said the gold or the premium platform of men and women providing the work here, just the opportunities to turn this country, you know, into the next generation on the energy is extremely exciting for the United Association.
Great, thank you. Thank you so much, Mark. And I think we just have enough time for one round of questions of each of the panelists. I'm gonna go back to Lonnie. And we're short on time here. So Lonnie, as you stated in your opening, the IBEW's membership can be found in nearly every corner of energy systems. Can you help contrast some of your various interests and identify which legislation and policies can ensure job quality as the energy mix transitions? You're muted, Lonnie.
Yep. Thank you, Melanie, and for that question. Let me start by saying, you know, our current energy transition can mean endless opportunities for IBEW members now and into the future. That's if it's structured correctly. As I said in my introduction, the IBEW represents workers in virtually every sector of energy, from coal and gas to solar and wind, from nuclear power and to the transmission and delivery. The IBEW energy jobs are solid middle-class union jobs, and they support families and communities, the kinds of jobs that we need if we're going to build back the economy better. But sadly, too many of the new renewable jobs aren't necessarily union jobs. Of the 50 highest value solar projects currently under development outside of California, only 14 are union. Of the 50 value wind projects, only 11 are union. And these are just the big jobs. It gets worse when you talk about the smaller ones. So making sure that lawmakers tie renewable tax credits, which have been so vital to the growth of green power, to strong labor protections is a major priority for us. One of these protections is prevailing wage laws, which studies have shown to promote higher incomes, safer workplaces, and increased productivity. Another protection are local hire provisions. These promote racial and gender diversity and channel money back into the communities where these projects are being built. It's also crucial that we crack down on the misclassification of workers as independent contractors. This is an all too common problem, especially in construction. It cheats workers out of the basic labor protections and vital benefits like Social Security and workers' compensation. We need to buy American provisions that make sure that federal investments rejuvenate the domestic manufacturing. And we must promote apprenticeship programs like the IBEWs and all the other building trades as well, that result in debt-free careers. Finally, we need expanded collective bargaining rights to renewable workers that can freely join unions. And one more thing to add to that. I agree with President Biden that we need all of the above energy mix and recognizes carbon capture, nuclear power, and other clean power sources as necessary to reach the net zero emissions that promote union jobs. Before wrapping up, I do want to mention how excited I am that labor is getting behind a single candidate for the FERC commissioner. Tom Dalzell, of course, brings years of union experience to the job, but even more importantly, he understands energy policy. He's worked with stakeholders across California to help meet the state's climate and energy goals, and I know that he'll bring that kind of leadership to DC. So I want to thank my fellow labor leaders for their support. In closing, the IBEW is ready to get to work. We're ready to build and lead America's energy revolution, and we're ready to transition to the clean power future and build our economy and middle class back better. So thank you again for the opportunity. I appreciate being part of this panel.
Great. Thank you, Lonnie. And we're gonna turn next to Maria. And Maria, let me ask you, when we think about our energy future, the energy mix might look very different than it does today. What does that mean for jobs, and how can nuclear provide a cushion for the expected job losses in the fossil fuel industry, particularly in the oil industry?
Well, thanks, Melanie. Actually, there's so much synergy in the job market. If you look at the nuclear jobs and the fossil fuel energy jobs, you know, my time in the nuclear industry, we would invite the fossil fuel folks to our sites for outage work, for modification work. So we worked hand in glove with our fellow workers in the fossil fuel industry. And so as we think about transitioning the energy sector, there is a warm welcome mat for the fossil fuel folks to transition over into the nuclear energy industry. And I know with all of the great opportunities for training that all of the labor organizations provide, there will be a smooth transition. And as you look ahead, think about the energy structure is already built. The energy highway, if you will, is already built from a transmission perspective. So it would be crazy not to use it. And what does that mean? That means to reuse sites that already have generation. So think where you have a coal site today. That could be a small modular reactor. Or think where you have a gas plant today. That could also be a nuclear plant. And so if we bring the plants to the places that currently house fossil fuels, we will then offer those workers jobs right where they're at.
Great, terrific. That's great to hear, Maria.
We're running a little over. Can we finish up here within about 5 minutes?
Yes. We started late, okay? And I talked about women, so it's my fault. Okay, I'm gonna turn to Tom Q. Tom, the generation sources are very different by region of the country. I'm sure you have to deal with that issue every day. Should our national policies accommodate these regional differences, both in technology and policy solutions for deep decarbonization of the electricity sector?
Well, you're absolutely right. There are many regional differences, and we have to take that into account and basically establish policies that will recognize those regional differences. And wind and solar, are going to be important tools to get us to where we need to get, but they're not always available in different places. It's going to be very important, as we said, to maintain nuclear and natural gas and the other carbon-free technologies that we need to develop to get us there. But transmission is going to be incredibly important. We got to expand that transmission system. We're now spending over $100 billion a year on hardening, undergrounding, storage, microgrids, EV charging stations, you name it. And that's got to continue. We're pleased with the provisions in the American Jobs Plan that give tax credits that are going to establish a grid deployment authority to help us work on siting and permitting, which is always a challenge. I think that again, it's going to be very, very important that labor and industry work closely together to make sure the jobs are there that we need to have to transition to this clean energy economy.
Great. Thank you so much, Tom. I'm going to turn to Karen now. And Karen, some communities have proposed increased electrification and in some cases bans on natural gas use in buildings. Where do you stand on this? What's your position? And you've got 50 words or less, okay? So, yeah,
joking. Well, we've all talked about the scale of the challenge of addressing climate change. And so I'm for not taking any solution off the table. We're going to need it all. We've got 2.6 million miles of pipeline in the ground, covered, protected right now. And it's delivering cleaner natural gas to those 180 million Americans. But also it can be used for the fuels of the future. We're investing in hydrogen, as I mentioned, $100 million. We're working with Secretary Granholm to continue to up that number with the appropriators. Renewable natural gas. So this system has such value to deliver clean, affordable energy today. An average family saves about $880 if they have access to gas, delivering cleaner energy today and increasingly cleaner advanced fuel technologies in the future. Don't leave a solution on the table. We can't afford it.
Great, thank you so much. And Mark, back to you finally. What job skills should we be focusing on for the clean energy transition from the perspective of your union? And we're gonna need to build out the grid and build out transmission and build out generation. What job skills do you think that we need to be focused on and training? Can you say a little bit about training needs?
Yeah, we spend about $250 million a year, the United Association, every year. In 4 years, we spend $1 billion in training without any federal grants whatsoever. We've been doing that for 132 years. We will pivot and navigate what the industry dictates to us, from welders all the way on to pipeliners, to pipe fitters, to steam fitters, to plumbers and sprinkler fitters. I'll yield some of my time back. We are ready to go to work. The United Association, the National Building Trades is ready to go for work. We're looking for a good level playing field with good labor protections in there. We'll be ready to go on all the skill sets of the future for the United Association.
Great. Thank you. And thank you to this wonderful panel. I would point out that we took precisely the amount of time we were given. Okay. We just started late. So this is a very disciplined panel and terrific to hear from you all. And thank you for your insights. And I'm going to turn it back over to Joe. An applause for the panel. Thank you. Bye-bye.
Thank you. Thank you, Melanie. And thank you to all of our panelists. As I said at the beginning of this program, we have a very tightly packed program today that we're trying to cover a lot of ground. And so with that, I'm going to move on now to our second panel, which is really going to address issues related to industry decarbonization. And I'm pleased to welcome David Foster. David was the founder of the Blue Green Alliance, and he now serves as a distinguished associate with us at EFI, and he's going to lead the next discussion, which is entitled Manufacturing Matters: How Industrial Decarbonization Can Rebuild America's Supply Chains. David?
Well, thank you. Thank you very much, Joe, and good afternoon to all who have joined us, and thank you for this important conversation about the future of manufacturing in America. I'm going to be joined by four colleagues who I've had the privilege of working with for most of two decades. Roxanne Brown, who's the international president of the United Steelworkers, Heidi Brock, the CEO of the American Forest and Paper Association, Lou Schorsch, retired CEO of ArcelorMittal Steel Americas, and finally, Conrad Winkler, who is the president and CEO of Ardagh Glass North America. As many of you know, over 20% of greenhouse gas emissions in our country come from manufacturing, with 70% of those from a handful of energy-intensive industries, including steel, aluminum, pulp and paper, glass, chemicals, and cement. And yet we know our economy's future and many of the climate investments necessary to decarbonize the economy depend precisely on the products made by these very industries. So today we'll hear from representatives of several of those businesses and the union that represents many of their employees. I want to start by asking each of you a framing question. First, to Lou Schorsch, as former CEO of what was the largest steel company in North America, how should we think about the process of decarbonizing the steel industry?
Thanks, Dave. I think you have to admit it's a tremendous challenge. Let's start there. If I just set the line for us, the U.S. consumes over 100 million tons of steel annually. And the blast furnace route, which is what most people have in mind when they think about steel production, generates about 2 tons of carbon dioxide and greenhouse gases for every ton of steel you make. So that gives you some idea of the scale of the challenge. The reason for this carbon intensity is the fact that steel producers use carbon primarily as a chemical reductant rather than as an energy source. So we take some form of iron oxide, you combine it with carbon, and you get iron and carbon dioxide as the outputs, to keep it very simple. Now, the waste gases and heat from this process are used to generate the energy throughout the steel plant, so energy efficiency is critically important. Nevertheless, the principal challenge for steel is how to execute the chemical reduction of iron oxide without emitting greenhouse gases. Now, there's an alternative to the blast furnace route, the electric furnace, that typically generates about 40% of the carbon of the greenhouse gases, the blast furnace route. This is because its major input is scrap, which doesn't require a chemical reduction. Electric furnaces now account for around 2/3 of steel production, and underlie the fact that the U.S. has a low carbon emissions rate relative to global competitors in this industry. But to be very honest, this is kind of cheating. Our high electric furnace share is only enabled by the fact that we import around a third of the steel that we consume. You could further reduce US carbon emissions in the steel industry by importing more steel products, which would in turn increase scrap availability. But besides the catastrophic effect that would have on the good jobs that are the focus of this conference, it really wouldn't have any benefit in terms of reducing greenhouse gas emissions globally. Globally, about 80% of steel is produced through that blast furnace route. So you need to address that. In the medium term, technologies like carbon capture and storage could solve the problem for existing facilities in steel and other carbon intensive industries. But we need hundreds of these facilities to really make a difference, not just the handful we have today. Longer term, new carbon-less technologies for producing steel would have to be introduced and adopted, but that's an enormous scientific and technical challenge. Funding both that medium term and the long-term solution is a major concern for any steel producer, to say the least.
Thank you so much, Lou. And now let's move on to Heidi Brock, who serves as the CEO of the American Forest and Paper Association and previously headed up the Aluminum Association. So Heidi, you've had a lot of experience. Tell us a little bit about your industry and the key pathways forward for addressing climate change from your various companies' perspectives.
Oh, well, thank you, David, for this wonderful opportunity for moderating, and our thanks to the Energy Futures Initiative and the Labor Energy Partnership for bringing us together to reflect on the opportunity to advance and grow U.S. manufacturing while also advancing a brighter future for the environment. So our paper and wood products industry recognizes that it takes partnerships across the entire value chain to keep people safe while supplying essential products in more sustainable ways. This pandemic proves that it takes responsible and committed partners working together to achieve results. And that kind of partnership work is critical to the American Forest and Paper Association, where we advocate for policies promoting continued progress in meeting the challenge of our changing climate. The forest products industry is a major driver of the US economy. This industry employs about 950,000 American workers, many of whom are members of the United Steelworkers Union, and we value the partnership we have with Roxanne Brown and her colleagues at the USW. The industry also accounts for about 4% of total US manufacturing GDP and manufactures nearly $300 billion in products annually. And just to help you visualize our footprint, know that there are more than 300 mills across the United States, with many of these mills in small rural communities where papermaking forms the backbone of the local economy, including my own hometown of Walla Walla, Washington. As a trade association for a leading manufacturing sector, we are committed to using fact-based public policy and marketplace advocacy to build bipartisan consensus on a wide range of issues, such as worker safety, the continued success of paper recycling, and sustainable manufacturing. So important to our conversation today is the fact that paper and wood products manufacturers produce enormous amounts of carbon beneficial bioenergy, integral to the making products that meet essential needs. The pandemic has really put a spotlight on our products. It's everything from the delivery box that lands on your doorstep, paper bags at the grocery checkout, tissue products that provide convenience and hygiene, and paper-based packaging used to protect and ship medical supplies. We make products from renewable and recyclable resources and are committed to continuous improvement through sustainability. In fact, AFMPA was one of the first US manufacturing industries to adopt a comprehensive, quantifiable set of sustainability goals about a decade ago. And this initiative, which is called Better Practices, Better Planet, demonstrates our commitment to sustainability. Included in this effort is a goal to reduce greenhouse gas emissions. Our original goal that was shared more than 10 years ago was to reduce industry emissions by at least 15%. But when our members surpassed that goal, we raised the bar, increasing it to 20%, which they achieved with a 23.2% reduction as of 2018. The industry's successful track record in cutting greenhouse gas emissions is about half since the 1990s. Looking forward, we are excited to soon release the industry's new sustainability goals for 2030. And we plan to announce the goals shortly, and they will include a new ambitious target for greenhouse gas reduction. We also plan to continue on a path of doing more with less by undertaking effort like maximizing use of resources, using recycled fiber, reusing water, and utilizing manufacturing residuals and byproducts to produce renewable bioenergy. Importantly, we are a significant contributor to our country's base of renewable energy, producing more carbon beneficial bioenergy than any other industrial sector. In fact, on average, about two-thirds of our members' energy demand is met through renewable bioenergy. Our industry's path to success in surpassing future greenhouse gas emissions goals is a path that includes continued use of much less carbon-intensive fuels, the adoption of energy-efficient manufacturing methods, and the continued use of bioenergy. Again, thank you, David, for this opportunity, and I look forward to the conversation.
Thank you very much, Heidi. That's terrific to hear about your successes. And now I'd like to turn to another old colleague, Conrad Winkler, the CEO of Ardagh Glass North America. Conrad, you've been a CEO both in steel and in glass, two of the world's energy-intensive industries. Tell us about the opportunities you've seen in both industries to lower carbon emissions while building a stronger business.
Great. Thanks, David. It's certainly great to be on this panel and an honor to be with these panelists, as well as leaders from government and other industries and unions. So, you know, it's interesting. I had a chance as the CEO of Evraz North America to launch a project to make an electric arc furnace-based steel plant in Colorado, the first solar-powered steel plant in the United States and perhaps in the world, using over 1,000 acres of land. And as Lou pointed out, maybe not all steel will come from electric arc furnaces, but nevertheless, obviously a big step. And what I wanted to point out was that getting something like that done definitely required the combination of government, labor, industry, power industry to make it happen. But at the end of the day, the economics really have to work. And they really did. I mean, in our case for that, it gave us basically the ability to set rates long into the future, have absolute certainty about what those power rates were going to be, and then enabled more than $500 million investment to follow because of the economics around it. So these things always have to be connected. And I was thrilled to be a part of that. Now, as CEO of Ardagh Glass North America, we already have one site launched with solar, and we're launching a second one. We have one in New Jersey, and then another one launching now in California that will operate with something like 15 to 50% of the energy for that facility supplied with renewable solar power. But the truth is, to get those things to work, again, the economics, you know, have to follow. Otherwise, those things don't happen. And that's why the role of government in this is so important, especially with these significant capital expenditures. Our goal, by the way, by 2030 is to be 100% renewable on our electricity usage. I guess the other big piece that I was going to bring up was recycling, especially for steel, another one where recycled material is incredibly important. But also for glass. In glass, there's a huge opportunity. Right now, 20% of the US states provide 80% of the recycled glass. In the United States, 30% of glass is recycled, whereas in Europe, the number is between 70 and 90% recycled. And every time we use glass, cullet as it's called, recycled glass instead of raw materials, we save significant amounts on the greenhouse gas generation as well. So a huge opportunity there for us to move towards greater recycling in the country, and very much aligned with, I think, the objectives of everyone here on the panel and in an industry. And then the last thing I was just going to bring up is the new technologies are so critical. Right now in the Ardagh Group, we're launching future hybrid-based glass furnace, which could reduce greenhouse gases by somewhere around 50 to 80%. So very big step. And I would really like to see us doing that here in the United States, not just getting the hybrid test furnace up and running in Europe. So with that, again, thanks again for having a chance to participate. And I think there's a lot we can do working together across industry, labor, and government.
Great. Thank you very much, Conrad. And great to see you in person for the first time since the pandemic. And now let's turn to the perspective of the employees who work in these industries, as well as many other manufacturing sectors. Roxanne, as International Vice President of the United Steelworkers, you've been at the center of the discussion for many years about how to preserve domestic jobs in these industries while also addressing the climate crisis. What are the essential elements of the United Steelworkers program to move forward on climate change while preserving American jobs?
Thanks, Dave. Thanks for the question. And it's a pleasure to be with everyone today. It's been a great afternoon. So our union starts with the very basic premise that the U.S. can't effectively build out the technologies, infrastructure systems, and products needed to solve the climate crisis without a strong and robust domestic manufacturing sector. We also very much challenge the notion that today's existing jobs at U.S. Steel and paper mills, copper mines, and at cement, chemicals, and glass facilities can't also be the jobs of tomorrow. It's not an either we solve climate change or we have good union jobs dilemma in our perspective. We believe that there are ways to ensure both environmental and economic sustainability. But to do this, a few things are necessary: investment, supporting the supply chain, and equity. In terms of investment, there was a recent McKinsey article that said it would take between $15 billion and $25 billion annually over the next decade to upgrade aging plants and equipment. And their focus in terms of this capital and directing this capital was roughly on 120,000 small and medium-sized facilities. Before the COVID pandemic, domestic manufacturing was not in the best place for various reasons, many of them related to unfair trade. And of course, the pandemic layered on additional pressures. But you know, this uncertainty led to companies across the economy holding off on the types of long-term investments they needed to upgrade their facilities and processes. And we strongly believe that policy measures to help support investments in domestic industry, and specifically investments in technologies like combined heat and power, like Heidi talked about, waste heat recovery, carbon capture, direct air capture, bioenergy, again, a technology that Heidi touched on, and other technologies to help decarbonize industry are really key, because this is how we ensure that these facilities and these jobs have a path into the future. In terms of supporting the supply chain, and in our union, we say that the products USW members make and the services they provide are cradle to grave and everything in between, because our members touch the value chain of the entire US economy in some way, whether it's critical materials, glass, boxes, aluminum, chemicals, titanium, cement, or steel. I could go on. Many of the products USW members make or mine every day are required components for the clean energy economy. And whenever tax dollars are used for infrastructure or clean energy projects, US-made products should be sourced. Our members are proud of what they do and what they make every day, and they're incredibly proud to supply America. And finally, and this has been touched on in various ways today, equity. The jobs that each of us are talking about today are good family-sustaining jobs. These are the jobs that have not only helped to build a nation, but have built families and communities as well. So as we talk about preserving jobs and creating jobs in the fight to address climate change, we have to make sure that equity for workers is built in by allowing workers the opportunity to form a union and negotiate for higher pay and benefits. This is how we achieve the economic sustainability portion of this fight. And, you know, it's been said many times, and we saw the passion from Secretary Granholm that is truly genuine, because in every interaction that our union has had with her so far, she's been consistent. And the Biden-Harris administration broadly has been very consistent in their support for union jobs and the PRO Act, and we appreciate that. It's important that collectively we are starting from a baseline of equity as we're looking into the future of jobs for workers and families in this country. Thanks, Dave.
Thank you so much, Roxanne. And I can see that we're running short on time here. So instead of another full round of questions, I'm going to ask each of you for kind of a lightning round. If there were one additional policy we haven't discussed today that you think would help advance manufacturing in the United States under this administration, what would that be? And give me 30 seconds, and I'm going to go in reverse order. So I'll start right back with you, Roxanne.
No pressure, no pressure at all. you know, it's something that was already discussed, and I hate to go back to this, but I really am excited about it. And Dave, you know, from your time at the Department of Energy, you know, it's an agency that is so critically important to domestic industry. It cannot be overstated. And I love the fact that Secretary Granholm referred to it as the Department of Solutions, because it really is. And all of the industries that are on this panel right here will need DOE to be, you know, leading the charge and on research, development, and deployment of critical technologies to ensure the survival, because we are talking about the survival of domestic industry and domestic workers, you know, and jobs into the future. So I just want to emphasize that point. It's not new, but it's a point that should be emphasized.
Great. Thank you, Roxanne. So DOE, you're on notice. Conrad. You're muted, Conrad.
Yeah. Back to DOE. Let me put it back on there. No, I think it really is. You know, I just couldn't agree more with you and Roxanne on this. It's if you think about the capital required to develop and build out these new technologies, it doesn't make sense for one company in the industry to figure the whole thing out and to take that kind of capital risk. So the DOE really does have an important role there in helping make those economics work. And then the other part that I would bring out, I touched on before, was just this whole, you know, how do we handle our recycling chains, and how are we going to work to make sure that we get the maximum out of recycling, especially in places where it takes down our greenhouse gases.
Great, thank you, Heidi.
Well, I love the comment on recycling, and I would just add that I think recycling policy is important, but as we address recycling policy, let's make sure that we recognize where it's working. And in the paper recycling space, it's working. So as we work to put in new initiatives, let's make sure we're careful to make progress and not go backwards. The other thing I would say is if we could recognize that at least in our industry, it's inherently a circular industry. So you've got the continuous regeneration of a renewable resource in the trees that supply fiber and enhance the environment, to using the biomass residuals from the manufacturing process to efficiently power our mills, and then on to recycling paper and packaging that's later recovered. But what we need as an industry is for Congress and other stakeholders to continue to support and recognize our industry and people as essential. And we need regulatory certainty designating our bioenergy as a fuel for the future.
Great, thank you. And finally, Lou.
Well, I think Conrad made some very good points based on his background, but maybe to be a bit provocative, I think for the new technologies you need in steel, I think we really need to think on a more global scale, as opposed to just we're going to develop these within the US. And that's not just to be a good global citizen, and it's certainly not to undermine an effort to be competitive and more competitive in our country, But I just don't know that we have the resources here in this country within the R&D departments of the steel industry, for example, to go after this in the kind of aggressive, innovative, creative way it needs to be done. I think most of those operations are really, they're more applied research. They're solving problems that are happening in the plant today or with a customer in the next year or so. The longer term challenges of really developing alternative carbon-free steel production technologies from the ground, from iron ore, I think is something that's going to be very daunting. And why not try to find a way to look at that on a more global basis?
Well, thank you all very much for a terrific discussion. And as I said before, it was really a delight to me to see all of you again and to be able to interact like this together. And with that, Joe, I'll kick it back over to you.
Thank you, Dave. That was great. And that was really good discussion. I really appreciated that lightning round. And so now I want to turn the program back to Secretary Moniz and President Trumka, who are going to now introduce our two very special guests for our wrap-up discussion, Congresswoman Kathy Castor and Senator Joe Manchin. So Secretary Moniz, the floor is yours.
Okay, well, thank you again, Joe, and I certainly do want to welcome our good friends, Congresswoman Castor, who chair of the House Select Committee on the Climate Crisis, and Senator Manchin. Is Senator Manchin here? I can't see him. Senator Manchin?
He's on the list there. I don't know if his video and audio are on yet.
Hi, this is Chris from Senator Manchin's office. We'll get him in a second. He's just finishing up another.
Okay. All right. Well, we'll soon welcome Senator Manchin from West Virginia, the chair of the Senate Committee on Energy and Natural Resources. Perhaps we can just jump in with a question to Congressman Castor. Rich, do you want to propose that question?
Sure. Congressman Castor, the action plan from the House Select Committee on the climate crisis says one of the best ways to ensure that a resilient clean energy economy is a fair economy is to strengthen workers' rights to organize a union and to negotiate higher wages and benefits. And for doing just that, it recommends the PRO Act. Why is a free and fair choice to join a union so important for answering the climate crisis?
Well, thank you, President Trumka. It's good to see you. It's great to see former Energy Secretary Moniz and, of course, Senator Manchin. And thank you for that very important question. You know, when Speaker Pelosi asked me to lead the Select Committee on the Climate Crisis, and we were tasked with developing a framework for congressional action to solve the climate crisis. No big deal, right? Solving the climate crisis. But what we understood from the outset is that solving the climate crisis is more than just reducing pollution. It's about creating a sustainable economy, one that values workers, that safeguards them, that also ensures environmental justice. So our 500 plus page roadmap that we released last year that is informing a lot of the Biden policy says that we have to invest in America's workers and build that economy that works for everyone. And that includes wages and working conditions. So the PRO Act is essential to that. And I'm proud to say we passed it in the House of Representatives already this year. We had a bipartisan vote. And now, hopefully, with Senator Manchin's help, we can get that through the Senate and to President Biden's desk. But that's not all. In addition to the PRO Act, our roadmap recommended Davis-Bacon, prevailing wage, strong Buy American policy, also community benefit agreements and project labor agreements for everything that we're going to be doing in clean energy and resilience and jobs.
Thank you.
Great. And that's a great tee up for Senator Manchin. I think you said something today about the PRO Act, as I recall, and you might want to comment on that, but I'll also ask a question You certainly have been a strong advocate of trying to generate bipartisan backing for the infrastructure plan. Perhaps you could talk a bit about that and how you see that plan or parts of the plan at least attracting the widest support possible.
First of all, let me make sure I'm okay. Can you all hear me?
Yeah, you're good.
Let me just thank everybody, my friends, Richard, I see my buddy, Rich Trumka, and Congresswoman, good to see you. And of course, Ernie, it's always good to be with you. First of all, I signed on to the PRO Act because I believe that we can come to an agreement. We can work this. And that, I think that where I come from, you know, we're used to good paying jobs that worked in the mine, benefits, retirements. You could live a quality of life with the skill sets you had and the hard work you were willing to provide. That's left us. And the thing that, Kathy, I would say on some of the, as we transition into new energy markets, if you will, we produce very little. We depend on foreign products being made overseas. All we do is assemble a lot of the, whether it be the windmills or solar panels, which is a bunch of crap, as far as I'm concerned, and we need to start building things. You give us a chance, give a coal miner a chance, we'll build you the best damn windmill you've ever seen or the best solar panel. But that's not the way the market's going. That's not the way the EV market. We do no batteries, okay? We're depending on the rest of the world, and here we sit on an unbelievable amount of energy, and we're losing the good jobs and basically the ancillary jobs that go with them. So we better watch what we're doing here, and I think that hopefully I can bring a little bit of an insight to the traditional jobs that we're about to lose for the transitional jobs that I'm not sure are going to be there. So that's why this PRO Act is important. It sure is. And is that market going to be able to sustain that? We're going to find out. We're going to find out really quick before we go down this path, because it could be a path to disaster if we don't do it and do it right. If we don't have the ability to have the wage earners that are willing to give what they have given in the past in the energy field. So there's so much that's going on right now. How do we transition? I think the energy bill that we have, or the infrastructure bill, is probably going to be broken up into probably three bills, maybe two to three, could be as many as four. But we've got to get something we can start doing in bipartisan. We haven't voted on a thing bipartisan in the Senate. The Senate's designed much different, Kathy, than the House, as you know. And if not, we'll have vicious swings if we can't get back into some element of working it. So anything I've said, give us a bill. Let's put the bill in the committee, in the jurisdictional committee. Ernie, you've been here long enough and watching things. Well, maybe they did work at one time, but they haven't worked for a long time. And the only thing I have said is, I remember Bob Byrd, and I know that Richard knew Bob Byrd very well too. Bob Byrd would keep you here on Friday night, Saturday, until you got wore out.
Yep.
He'd wear you out. Vote until your heart's desire, and then by God, let's move forward. And we don't do that anymore. We get here Monday at 5:30, and the jet fuel's burning by 2 o'clock on Thursday. They're out of here. So hell yeah, you better take the path of least resistance, because nobody wants to fight for what needs to be done. So put the bill, anything I've said, put it in the committee, let it go through the committee as far as a hearing, have the markup, and have the committee staff write the bill, put it on the floor, and have an open amendment process that basically is going to be germane to the subject matter. And by the time that's done, people have gotten, we're going to get something. We're going to get something. And we have a chance to really bring some points to the market. But right now, all the people that are hammering over clean, green, well, that's wonderful. Guess what? The rest of the world needs technology. And that comes from innovation for us to clean it up. And I think, Ernie, we've talked about this. Carbon capture sequestration is a thing that'll do more to help the global climate and environment in the world than probably anything else we could do.
I would just add to the CCS, although there's overlap, the issue of carbon dioxide removal as well from the atmosphere as an important direction.
Yeah. Well, we're talking about what the clear, what they call clean air.
Well, we had a report called Clearing the Air.
That's it.
That's right.
Okay. It's like you've had a lot of good reports, Ernie. Sometimes I get confused because you have so many good ones. Anyway, hey, gang, we're all in this together. And I got to think that there's enough Republicans truly that understand that we're up against it. They've got people in their own areas are having the same, okay?
Fire.
And they're, and Rich, you know, we've lost a lot of Democrats who started voting Republican because they thought we left them. We got to show them that we're back.
Rich, do you want to follow up?
Sure. You know, Senator Manchin, you and I have, I think we've known each other since you lost one of your loved ones in the 69.
Uncle John, explosion. 1968, buddy.
Yeah. And I think that's when we first met, and we've been walking together since there. You and I both come from the coal fields. We know those are good paying jobs, and we know that they sure matter to the entire community. If those jobs are going to be replaced by clean energy jobs, how do we make sure that, it's a two-part question. One, before those jobs are lost, we invest in our coal field communities. How do we do that, Joe?
Well, here's the thing. I simply went back in 2009. I was talking to President Obama. I said, you know, a lot of credits were going towards wind and solar. And I said, sir, if you're going to go wind and solar and you have that prerogative and everything, you still have to have baseload fuel 24/7. That's where we come in. And we've cleaned up the environment more than the last two decades than ever before. And now if we can just get CO2, we'd be in great shape. But anyway, I said, if people are going to take advantage of these credits, make them use the credits in the areas with basically the jobs have been lost, the traditional jobs. So only thing now, as I've been on Zooms all day on energy. First of all, I understand that there's not a United States company that can compete for offshore wind. It's all overseas. They just can't compete because they don't have the ability to compete. And then next of all, the solar panels and most of all the GE makes the turbines for the wind, but all the components and everything are doing overseas, Brazil, different places around the world. We do very little of any of this. And all of a sudden here, and I've said this, you take one coal job, I guarantee you, you'll find a battery factory somewhere. You'll find a cable company. You'll find machine shops. You're going to find seven or eight people that are supplying that one. So guys, I don't think the supply chain and labor supply chain is going to be anywhere close to what we've had. So what type of investments are you making then? What type of investments is the federal government or the taxpayers willing to do? You sure as hell can't leave us behind, Rich. And they asked me politically, we're speaking politically now. They said, hey, Joe, what happened to West Virginia? I says, nothing. What happened to the country? We feel like the returning Vietnam veteran. We've done every dirty job you want us to do, took our orders, never complained, did the heavy lifting, and now we're not good enough, we're not clean enough, we're not green enough, and we're not smart enough. So the hell with you. I'll vote for somebody else. That's how we lost West Virginia. They don't want to hear it, but that's what happened.
Joe, the second part of that question, as clean energy industries grow, how do we make sure they're good family supporting jobs? And by the way, I want to thank you from the bottom of my heart. We're so grateful you're signing on as a co-sponsor to the PRO Act. And I know you're going to do what's necessary to bring our colleagues along. How do we make sure that those new jobs are good paying family supporting jobs like the ones we had?
You know, we fight for a prevailing wage, and also we fight for the right. I mean, Rich, you know, I didn't realize this. Do you know that over 50% of the companies that tried to unionize and had a union, a positive union vote, didn't make it?
Yeah, because they weren't allowed to get a contract. Even
they
after allowed,
they couldn't get a contract and organize.
Yeah.
Now,
after they go
wrong,
through all
guys.
The hoops and all the threats and all the meetings, they still don't get a contract because a company just says no.
Now, you tell me that I can't find 10 Republicans that say that's fair, that's the way business. I just want to work it. I think I can bring out the human element in these types of, because you know why? I can find an uncle or grandfather they had that went through this. I can find someone in their lineage that understands what we're trying to do, Rich. That's why I jumped on the bill. I said, I want to work this. If I get in there, I can work it. I couldn't work it from the outside. I can work it from the inside. And that was the purpose of it. And if they have some better way to do it, but like you said, they have to be a prevailing wage. They have to pay prevailing wages. We can't allow that. And maybe that's why they're overseas. But here we are, we're camouflaging it like everything's hunky-dory. Let them go ahead. You know, what gets me is we're going to a complete, Ernie, they're going to a complete EV. This bill, the infrastructure bill, is all around EVs, okay? Well, who's going to tell the families who are being enslaved in Angola, keep digging, gang. Get more, get grandma and grandpa out there. Let them keep digging for us, okay? There's no responsible resource sourcing. And then China could care less. And here we are, our whole, our transportation fleet is going to be changed to EV. And we have no control over the source. None. Why don't we go to green hydrogen? Why don't we do things that we have control over?
I would just add, Senator Manchin, that earlier Secretary Granholm, we had a discussion about how to build a supply chain in that EV space, including domestic mining, including substitution materials through innovation, and hydrogen as well. So we agree on the strong supply chain focus. If I could just change the discussion a little bit, a question you could both could answer. Let me start with Congresswoman Castor about the grid and grid modernization. The tragic events in Texas 2 months ago showed the costs of having not having a modern resilient grid. As chair of the select committee, what steps do you see for us and for Congress to take to get us to a different place?
Yeah, thank you for that, and God bless those families in the state of Texas. It was just a complete catastrophe, and they had, you know, the folks there running part of the energy system. They had been warned before to make the grid and energy sources more resilient, and they didn't do it. So we want to make sure that that those power producers get the resources, maybe a little more stick than carrot approach this time to upgrade the grid. But the linchpin to solving the climate crisis and doing it in a way that supports workers and with an eye towards equity and environmental justice is the modernization of the grid across our great country. And that's going to be mean different things to different regions of the country as we connect up new power supplies. We help bring in the latest technology, Secretary Moniz, that you've educated me on along the way. But we are recommending a $100 billion investment in modernizing the grid. And that's not just expanding the transmission system, but that's also this important resiliency protection so we don't see those catastrophes. Because let's face it, it's getting hotter and hotter out there. The most of the stresses on the electrical grid are going to come from extreme heat and overuse. And if we're not ready, we're going to unfortunately face a lot of, we'll face additional loss of life and greater expense on the backside.
Yeah, you mentioned heat. When, of course, in Texas, it was cold. And I think that just points out that we have so many extremes that we have to deal with. And frankly, I think we still do too much of expecting the weather tomorrow to be like the weather yesterday instead of generating a new risk profile.
I come from the state of Florida. I can tell you that is not the case. And the folks in Texas, that what a catastrophe. So now is the time to make those far-reaching investments, but do it in a way, I mean, when you're modernizing the grid, those are good American jobs. Those aren't jobs that are going to be, from any other country. So that means you plan ahead. This is about building those coalitions. There are so many great training initiatives among our labor brothers and sisters, so many apprenticeship programs, and the jobs are all up and down the spectrum here. But this is really going to be the linchpin going forward. And then it's good to see President Biden following through with his commitment that we're going to prioritize communities that maybe coal country. I mean, we owe a huge debt of gratitude to energy workers who have built this country into what it is today. So we cannot forget them, whether it's their health care, their pensions, the tax base in those communities. But we need an administration, an entire coalition to make good on those promises and stay committed to it year after year after year.
In fact, you mentioned Florida, and your district, I think, includes Tampa, which is exposed to these so-called once-in-a-century events that seem to be occurring once every few years. I trust that your constituents are feeling this urgency to modernize.
You bet they are. We hit an all-time heat record last year. And think about the workers who have to work every day outside in that heat, whether it's folks building new plants or it's the agriculture community, farm workers. I mean, it is a pressing crisis. Plus, our property insurance market is a little wacky. It's getting much more expensive. Mm-hmm. So all of those, you have to factor in all of those costs as you're building a coalition for climate action now. But yes, we're very concerned about what lies ahead unless we take ambitious action all together, try to do as much in a bipartisan way as we can.
Okay. I think we've just lost Senator Manchin, but that's okay. Rich, shall I hand it back to you?
You know, Congresswoman Castro, I just want to thank you. You mentioned a couple of things. The Emergency Rescue Act also took care of pensions. And I don't want anybody to forget what you did and what the Democrats on the Senate side did to protect the pensions of people that were in crisis because of the pandemic. And you stood up for that. And I want to thank you for that. Also want to thank you and the administration and the Senate Democrats for giving 100% COBRA health care to people during a pandemic. That literally is the difference between living and dying. And I want to say thank you for that. You've always had our back. And all I can say is thank you on behalf of all the workers out there. And we look forward to working with you to making a better America that represents and takes care of all workers out there and gives everybody an equal chance to succeed.
Well, I hope that demonstrates our commitment for the days ahead. But the American Jobs Plan, it's an all hands on deck moment, and I'll look forward to hammering this out. And hopefully, Senator Manchin's doing some of that right now.
one last question, if I may, to circle back to the beginning, in a certain sense. I mean, the president had a bipartisan meeting this week on the job plan. What's your view on bipartisanship possibilities in the House?
Well, first, isn't that a breath of fresh air in Washington to have the President of the United States listening to folks from all sides? And I know he's eager to get out and about across the country a little bit too when we can crush COVID. Here in the House, it's difficult coming out of a violent insurrection and the COVID days where you don't have the opportunity to personally interact as often, but we're talking a lot about what is possible. There are a lot of members who don't know a Congress that is functional where you do large infrastructure and jobs packages, and they're hearing from their communities back home. And I think that's the important piece. You know, if you talk infrastructure to folks back home, it's wildly popular, no matter your political persuasion. And so to build the broad coalition we need to pass the American Jobs Plan, one that's based on fair labor standards, strong labor standards for workers and environmental justice, we folks back home have got to weigh in with their policymakers here in the Congress. Tell them, let's go. Let's come out of COVID. Let's come back stronger than we've been. Let's solve the climate crisis and do it in the right way.
Well, thank you. I'm sure I speak for my friend Rich in saying that we're all available to to help in that push for you and Senator Manchin, of course, as well in the Senate. So thank you very much for your time and for your 500 pages of select committee report. And hopefully we're going to see big parts of that now getting into law. Thank you
so much.
Yeah. Okay. Terrific. Well, we're a few minutes over, but Rich and I would like to just make one more statement, one more announcement. Before concluding this virtual roundtable, what we're announcing is first that Breakthrough Energy is endorsing and generously supporting this labor energy partnership with an award that allows us to pursue our core objective of planning broad-based climate solutions, quality job growth and retention, and social equity. Today's workshop is part of our LEP program, and we are also today publishing, it's now posted, the results of our previous roundtable held a few weeks ago on offshore wind. We just referred to that, offshore wind, and how do we build a domestic supply chain to in fact support that offshore wind initiative. We've posted up here on the screen are some of the takeaways, but I'm going to leave that to you to read off of the website. But that was part of our LEP work. And moving forward, we are going to have at least five additional regional workshops, one on resilient infrastructure, where we will focus in the Gulf states, one on metals and minerals, what we've heard a lot of today in terms of the supply chain and how we can make that domestic, and that will be in the Rocky Mountain West. We'll look at opportunities for clean hydrogen in the Carolinas, another subject we heard about today. We'll look for pathways to introduce CCS and hydrogen projects in the Ohio River Valley. And we'll look at the current and future role of nuclear energy in the upper Midwest. So again, we're going to have a busy year, and this is only part of it. We're going to be together in Glasgow and promote these ideas of energy transition with high quality jobs. And again, the support from Breakthrough Energy enables these activities. In this case, the workshops, the roundtables that will focus on specific technologies, regional variations in energy transition solutions, and coalitions of union members, industrial leaders, policymakers, social equity activists, and other local stakeholders to discuss decarbonization pathways. So again, it'll be a year of intense activity for the Labor Energy Partnership. And thanks again to Breakthrough Energy. And for Rich and me, thank you to all of you for taking part today in this roundtable.